In this video, I will show you how to install everything on Linux, or rather I will do it myself. So far I only opened the lectures repository here and downloaded the introduction file to copy the necessary links from, and I will download Miniconda. So if you're uncertain if you want to download Anaconda or Miniconda, just install Miniconda, because Anaconda simply installs Miniconda and then on top of that installs the meta package Anaconda. So simply running conda install Anaconda, and what this conda install Anaconda simply does, it installs some like 160 packages into your base environment. And because we don't recommend, and it's good practice to not use your base environment for anything, like what's the purpose of having these 160 environments in your base anyway, packages in your base environment anyway. So I don't recommend to use Anaconda. It just clutters your system with more than 3 gigabytes, whereas Miniconda is this 80 megabytes. Alright, so I downloaded Miniconda here, and now let's follow the instructions. So open the terminal here. This command exists on my machine. If it doesn't, you can also open another terminal. You can just terminal, I think it should be rather the same for KDE and GNOME. And then you can copy this path here and install and paste using Control-Shift-P and change directory to that. Now we're here in downloads, and now in this I run the command bash tab to autocomplete, and but let's first run which Python, because I don't know which Python I have. I have the user bin Python. I have now pip list. These are my system Python environments. You can also look at how many I have by counting the words, the lines in here. And this is the command. Yeah, I have 91 packages in my system Python. And I just installed this user, so this is what my Linux machine needs. But let's install Miniconda here. Yes, I read that before I made this video. Is there no faster way through this? Okay, in my home directory /Miniconda3, that's definitely good. I always wanted to be in my home directory, so I confirm. Now we'll take a bit to install. To wish the install, yes, I want that to be the case. So, and then I want inside. Okay, so I have to close and reopen my current shell. So if I in this shell run which Python, it still takes my system Python because it added some stuff. So what it did now, it added some lines of code to files which are automatically executed once I run a new terminal. And as long as I have this terminal active, they don't get resourced. It's called sourcing. But if I open a new one, this is what I see. And I see here now, I'm in the base environment. So I didn't even need to init. For some shells, you see here, oh, look, that's new. I've never seen that. Cool. Okay, as we see here, so normally on some shells I would have to run conda init and then I think bash, because I'm using bash here. I think it's part of the script. So let's ask which Python we're using here, and now we know we're using the one from the Miniconda environment. And now let's conda list to see which. Many, and there are 39 in here, so they are less than in my system Python, because Anaconda, like Miniconda, doesn't install that many. My system Python just needs some stuff of my system Python, needs certain packages. Okay, do we have Git? Ah, yeah, I think it just it's just standard in Linux. Okay, I can also, why not conda update -- all. Probably pip is always an old version. Yes, sure. So yeah, we see not the newest. Okay. And now I have Conda. And Conda is two things. Conda is a package manager with which I can install Python packages, like for example NumPy, which we need for doing certain stuff in Python. Like pip. Pip installs packages. But Conda is not only a package manager. Package manager Conda is also doing virtual environments. And virtual environments in Python are useful, I already explained this. And now I always need to make sure, do I want to install stuff into my system Python, or rather into my base environment? Like, I never want to install stuff in my system Python. I sometimes want to install stuff in my base environment, and I most of the time want to install stuff into a certain Python environment, a Conda environment. So I want to install stuff in my system Python when I want to make changes, like which are globally on my system. Or if I want to run stuff, for example, which, like, if I want to change functionality of my operating system, basically. I want to install stuff into the base environment when I want to run stuff from my base environment, which kind of makes sense for Jupyter, I think, because I can also change my directory, change my environment in Jupyter. So I think I'm going to install Jupyter Lab here globally on my base environment. But everything else besides Jupyter and Jupyter Lab here, I want to install in my environment. So let's run conda install Jupyter here on my base environment. And we see this comes with many dependencies. So it's always recommendable. So sometimes conda can install stuff pip can't, and sometimes pip can install stuff that conda can't. But if you're using conda environment, which we are active, which we want you to do, because they're the same on Windows, Linux, and Mac, then it always makes sense to use conda install because of two reasons. Right, first of all, it's good to use conda because conda is like an all-in-one solution, which is nice. But it's useful to install stuff using conda instead of pip because conda is good at resolving dependencies, whereas pip isn't. So on pip, if you install if you install some package and that package needs, so if you install package B and package B needs package A in version 10 or higher, then pip is going to install package B and package A in version 10. However, if you then install package C and package C needs package A in version 9, then pip is just going to install your package C and package A in version 9. And thus you have a broken environment because package B doesn't work anymore. And that's bad. And conda doesn't do that because conda resolves dependencies good. So Python is really not the best generally at resolving dependencies, which is why enterprises prefer Java. But it's just conda is better at this as pip. And furthermore, in conda, if you install stuff with conda, what at least on Unix-based systems, what it's going to do, it's going to make a hard link for packages that are already on your system. Which means if you install NumPy into 20 environments, you just have one, and if it's the same version, you just have one NumPy. Oops, I wanted to be super. You have NumPy once on your system. The other just going to reuse this very same NumPy without cluttering your system, without actually taking a byte more, and that's also really useful. Okay, so conda list Jupyter Lab. Good, Chris. Conda install Jupyter Lab. These are not many dependencies. That's fine. Okay, now I should be able to run. Oops, I mean Jupyter Lab. Oh, I cannot. See, this is why we're doing this stuff here. Jupyter. Oops, there wasn't a space. Okay, and now we're running. Now we have open Jupyter here. I can create a markdown file. It's new. Token 6.5. I haven't seen that before. Maybe I should update my system. Okay, now. Inside this here, I see I'm again in my base environment. Now I can conda Info minus minus eins. I think there's also conda and info or something. Conda and list is the command. But it's literally the same thing. So yeah. Oh, my user isn't called Python test, not Python test. Well, that sucks. But I'm gonna delete it anyway. Okay, oh, and there's one I forgot. Install conda forge node.js. So conda is also able to install stuff from conda forge. So conda pip has one repository, which is the PyPI, the Python package index, and this is where pip installs your stuff from. They're like 150, no, whoa, they're just 230,000 different packages on Python package index. Conda can install from different, conda installs from other sources. So the problem here is when you install with pip that there could be anything, and if you pip install, you're not, everybody can upload stuff at the Python package index. And sometimes there could be malicious code. So if you pip install, especially if you sudo pip install, maybe the case that you run malicious code in your system because it simply runs some Python code, which could be a keylogger or something that grabs all your bank data. So it's not recommendable to sudo pip install. And generally, conda is like more checked than PyPI. But if you know what you're doing, PyPI also checks for man in the middle attacks. So you can also install with pip. Okay, as much for me talking here, and now we see we don't have the lab extension. Let's install this lab extension here. Hope I can just copy code. Yes, so I can just, oops, install the lab extension here. And this is simply to inspect variables. But we only need this in the first lecture, so it's not even relevant anymore. Alright. So now, npm dependencies fail to install. That's new to me too. Well, welcome to the first lesson in programming. Copy the error message into Google. No, that's not to do copy. If I build my Jupyter app, normally it should build on the first one. So this is not no fix, but it's just building it. Yeah, it's interesting. And we literally just installed Node.js, didn't we? So, is there conda uninstall? I hope there's conda uninstall. And then let's install this very specific version of Node.js. I'm gonna update that in the slides if that's actually a mistake. Yes, okay, so let's install the correct version and let's hope it works then. So this here works if you have an environment file, but because this is my base environment, I just like I don't have an environment file. So I just want to like my base environment exists once on my system, so I just want to stuff to work in my base environment. I don't need to create an environment file. Not available. Okay. And let's just not install that from conda forge. Aha. There we go. So now we can try to install that here. terrible at this. This needs to be changed. Okay. While that is happening, let's clone our lectures repository. Wait, what are we here? So let's, yeah, sure. Normally I would clone it into my, into my university directory somewhere, but there's a test account. So after cloning, I can change directory to lectures. And then once I'm here, I can conda env create. So minus n would create a new one, minus p would create an environment in a certain path, because normally they are in slash and home slash anaconda, miniconda 3 slash env. And minus p, minus f creates from a file, and this is the environment.yaml file. And this simply lists all the dependencies we need for our lectures repository. Plus conda automatically installing like all the libraries we need, plus conda automatically installing all the dependencies. So this here seemed to work, so sorry to have the wrong version of Node.js here. So now let's run Jupyter Lab here. You can have any terminal, like any number of terminals open you want. You're just going to see that eventually it gets cluttered. So what the variable inspector here simply does is, if we open a new Python 3 console, we say a plus 1 and run this, we can now open the variable inspector, and this will simply list us our names and variables. It's nice, it's absolutely not necessary. Okay, so cloning the installing all the packages, like I said, it should be on 170 if you're done. I think I'm just going to stop it and wait. Oh no, it's... Alright, so now it installs. So we can conda, what did I say, env list. Yeah. And now we see there's a new environment, and that's scientific programming. So we can conda activate scientific program. And now if we, well, first of all, if we run conda env list, it's going to indicate that this here is the active environment. And now if we conda list, we're going to see that a lot of stuff is installed. So for example, is pandas installed, conda list, and then pipe to that grab pandas. So this pipe means one something with the return, with the result of one in this here, and grab simply grabs a line. And we see we have installed pandas here. And if we run conda list and then pipe word count minus lines, behind that we see that we have 171 packages installed. So our environment.yaml specified which Python version we want to have, and if we check, we simply run Python, we see it's Python version 3.77, control D to exit Python. And if we would like another Python, we can also conda install minus n name of env python equals 3.6 or something that's TensorFlow, for example, often needs old Python versions. Okay, so we can conda deactivate, and now if we run which, so let's activate that again for a second, and now we see if we run which Python, we use the Python in the environment scientific programming. If we deactivate, we see we're in a base Python again, and we can even deactivate again, then we're in a system Python. In your system Python, you shouldn't change stuff, like I said before. So let's conda activate scientific programming again. Actually, I think it would be better to first conda activate, because thus, if you exit the scientific programming environment, you would go into the base environment again. Okay, yeah, the variable inspector. I install that into a base Python. Let's see. So jupyter is a dependency, so we can also just look into our environment.yaml files using, for example, cut. And we see that we install jupyter and jupyter Lapius. So this is the same as installing it here. And yes, we still haven't installed this variable inspector, but I probably also have again the wrong version of Node.js in here. So yeah, this would be the one file to rule them all. But yeah, this is Windows. We don't care for Windows. Now, after installation. Now, Michelle does indicate that we're in this environment. Yes. Activated. Yes. Condolist. Yes, we did that. Jupyter Lab. Yes, we did that. Getting the lectures repository to run. So, let's run Jupyter Lab. Actually, we can also run Jupyter Lab build instead of running Jupyter Lab. So, we said open Jupyter Lab and build recommended. But we can simply Jupyter Lab. Oops. Can simply Jupyter Lab build. I'm gonna add that to the slides too. So, conda, and we need Jupyter Lab. This takes a second, and then we can simply run the post build. Yeah, maybe we have to make it executable. So the chmod plus x post build changes the modifiers of our post build file and makes it and adds the executable modifier. So on Linux, you have modifiers who can read, write, and execute a file, user, group, and everybody, or sudo, I'm not sure. And chmod plus x makes a file executable, because if not, our post build should be. No? Where's my post build? Oh, yeah, so if I try to run post build without making it executable, permission denied. So this is why we have to make it plus x post build. So now it's executable, now we can run dot slash post build. And now it should be good to go. This installs some other dependencies which we need for the class. So let's look what it actually installs. So I clone my environment right here. Like I said, not good practice. So let's look at the post build file here. Open with LibreOffice. Oh Jesus. Okay, so this wants to be run with Bash. That's the shebang here. And then it simply sets some options and installs stuff like Jupyter Lab Manager, table of contents, variable inspectors. Oh, why did I tell you to run the variable inspector once again here? Okay, I'm updating the slides. Jupyter Lab Solutions, which is for making cells visible and invisible, and nice extensions to make everything pretty. And then case the output of our notebooks such that you can run from scratch. Okay, I think I'm gonna stop the video here for a second. I'm gonna pause the video here and I'm gonna continue once this is installed. All right, back again. It just went through. And so it actually takes quite a while. And what it then also does, it clears all our notebooks, which we can see here. So if we now run Jupyter Lab dot, we have a bunch of stuff in here. And for example, oh wait, there's no Python notebook in here. And there's a Python notebook. Now if we see, all outputs are clear, so I can just run through them all again. I think I can run all cells. Just kernel run all cells, for example. So now I'm clear here. And what I now also have is, for example, the table of contents, which is a nice add-on. I have the variable inspector. And what else was now possible? So the table of contents we saw here, and some other stuff. Alright, yeah, IPython widgets, and for example also the countdown, which is somewhere in some later lecture. Yeah, so here we import countdown. And now we see that this here renders nicely, and we can also see that we have solutions available here. So if you had seen these two things, you know it's properly installed. Okay, let me show you just one more thing, because this is the student's view for this Jupyter notebook, where we can review solutions. If you want to have the teacher's view, where you can make these solutions, shut down Control C and Y. If you want the teacher's view, you can make them instead of looking at them. What you can do is you can change the... Wait, what's the name of this part? So we moved the Jupyter notebook config here to the .jupyter. So what we need to do here is, so we could also, I think we can also overwrite the config here. So we could make, so we could for example make a new file Jupyter notebook config.py and paste the content into there. But so I'm going to change the system, right? So let's look into, actually let's open in our home directory /.jupyter/jupyter-notebook-config.py. What we see here is that for the Jupyter Lab solutions, well, first of all, this add-on is enabled. And second of all, the role here is student, and we could change the role here to teacher. And once we did that, and one Jupyter lab again. Oh, I still have some. Oh, I still have the one in the base environment open. See, it uses a different port, but still on localhost. But if we do that, what we see is that now we can, we have hint available and solution available, so we can mark stuff as hint, mark cells as hint, and mark cells as solutions. Just teaches you. So, yeah. Alright, that's all for this video.